And this happened with Center Stage when I initially started it 4 years ago. I just started it because I just got back from my Bollywood experience working with Ashutosh Gowalekar, and I worked with him on 2 flop films. After Lagaan, he made a movie called What's Your Rashi. Anyone's heard of it?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm amazed that you have. It's great. And I'm not judging you anyway. And then after that, he made another film called Khele Hum Ji Jaan Se. Anyone's heard of that? Abhishek Bachchan and Deepika. You guys have heard of it? You should hide your face, maybe not. I was the first assistant director on Khele Hum Ji Jaan Se, and I learned a lot from Mr. Gowalekar. I learned respect. I learned many things, and I also learned how to work on the Indian film set, because I finished my master's from NYU. I did my film master's from there. And I'm giving you guys a very little bit of and this is again in no way I'm bragging about what I've done. It's just so that this creative morning can be more interactive.
Because I know here that there might be people who are interested in a certain expertise or a certain core competence. And I would love to engage myself in understanding how I can help, because I recently read something, I saw a beautiful video and I want to just divert to that. Was something about sharing ideas or spraying ideas, no pun intended. So in that context, I want to just say that when I came back from the US and I started working in the Bollywood film industry, there were many new do's and don'ts. And especially after working with Mr. Gowalekar for 1.5 years and I got back to Bangalore, I realized that there was no real pot for talent. I don't know why I'm using words like pot and spray early in the morning, but I'm saying melting pot in terms of creative, yeah? So that's when Center Stage came to existence, and I started, the whole idea of Center Stage, it's been 4.5 years now. It just started off with a very basic acting workshop. Because when I was in New York, I went to a lot of different schools of thoughts, Sanford Meisner, Lee Strasberg, and everyone there was, the acting teachers, they weren't telling a particular student that this is how you're supposed to do it. This is acting, this is how it's supposed to be in front of a camera, or this is how you approach stage, or this is how you approach improvisation. They were giving actors like a buffet, and they were giving them a buffet and saying, you know what, what's your name, sir? What's your name? Saeed. So they'll say, Saeed, maybe this will work for you. What's your name, man? Divya. So they'll say, Divya, this will work for you because that's your strength. That's what they were doing. So I was thinking, why don't I bring that ideology? Because it's all about observation and what you see. So I thought I'd bring that ideology of just doing an acting workshop, which is not me saying as a trainer, not even a teacher, a trainer on the other side that, you know what, I know so much, you need to know everything that I know. I thought that kind of interaction would be a little harmful. So then what we decided was, we will talk about all the things that we know and all the things that's out there and give a buffet to aspiring actors. And then let's see what happens. And in no time, after my first workshop had about 11 students. And we did it at Baldwin's Methodist College way back in 2010. The second workshop had 24 students. And it just went on, and I think Center Stage now, we've got close to about 750 people that have trained with us. And out of the 750 people, I can really, really happily say that at least about 45 or 50 of them are working actors. And some of them have actually just moved and gone to Bombay, and some of them are here. And because of that Center Stage idea that happened, the first Hindi feature film plan happened, and that's when I was able to make that film in Bangalore. That took about 2 years, and it had, when I went to distributors in Bombay with the movie, it was 90 minutes, and I'm not quoting anybody, but this is what they said. You have ugly people in the film, you don't have an item number, you don't have a song that you can make an item number out of. How do you think this is going to get released? Literally. People, cab drivers who were driving and who overheard my conversation with my producer while we were heading for meetings would be like, "Ah, picture bana rahe ho?" I was like, "Yeah." Kone picture mein? I gave the names of the actors. Ko
evolo, who are those people? Why are you making it? Nature ega. I told them, he asked me, what's the story about it? It's about three assassins. Kya karte ho log? What are assassins? What do they do? It was literally like that. Anyway, with all that thing, luckily Lunchbox released, and PVR Directors Rare released Lunchbox. So I had a meeting with them, and over about 3 months of really, really meeting them, convincing them to watch 10 minutes of the movie. They weren't even watching. So distributors don't watch movies. I'll tell you why. One of the distributors, and I'm not going to name who it was, asked me in a very Bollywoodish style that how does it, someone come to watch a movie? For example, if I ask you, what's your name? Malvika, what makes you go watch a movie? Reviews. Lovely t-shirt, what's your name, sir? Chetan, what makes you go watch a movie? Reviews and trailers. Yeah, so trailers, so let's talk trailers. So he said, people come to watch a movie with a 2 minute trailer or a 1 minute trailer, is what the distributor said. I watched your trailer, I don't need to see the movie. Because what applies to the audience applies to me as well. If a trailer excites me, and if I see that there is something in the trailer, I don't want to watch the movie. So believe you me, they got in, the distributors, the two marketing guys got into the screening of my movie, Station, which was in 2013. They got out in 3 minutes. And they started discussing with my producer about, like, let's release the film. When Station released on March 28, 2014, with two amazing movies called Dishkyao and Youngistan. I'm being a little bit of an asshole, but when it released with these two movies, Station got reviewed in Bangalore Times. These other films didn't get reviewed. And when Station got reviewed, we got 2.5 stars. And they said, how can you make a gangster film in Bangalore? Because of which, a lot of Bangaloreans went to the movie. They're like, what? Let's show them some gangster swag. Anyway, I diverted again. When the distributors came out and they said they started planning the film release, we didn't have any budget for putting trailers on television. Because when you put a trailer spot on Colors, you need to pay a lot of money. I don't really know that. So if you have for example, Kapil Sharma, in between Kapil Sharma's show, if you have to get a trailer or a 30-second trailer or a teaser, you have to pay Colors a certain amount of money because that also goes into Kapil Sharma's kitty. So something, we're talking about 8 to 10 lakhs for a 30-second. 30-second, that's a minimum. If the film is new and if the makers, if the people on the other side think that the makers have the money, it's a lot more than. Alright? So somehow with all the great Bangalore energy, we went to every college and I pretty much did the same thing that I'm doing now. Went to colleges, did interactive sessions, showed the trailer, showed snippets of the movie, talked to people. A large number of people ended up going to the theatre. And the film in Bangalore, in Bangalore ran for 2 weeks. In Bombay ran for a week, in Kolkata ran for a week, but in Bangalore ran for 2 weeks and it was about to get to the third week. And that's when the distributors said that, you know, when your film released with Youngistan and Dishkyao, there were 188 films in the can at that day that could have gotten a release. You can just look at the statistics, it's insane. So I'm here because I think I'm incalculably lucky. It has nothing to do with my talent. I'm being very honest and I know it might just make you a little bit surprised. It's the fact that all of us are here and I'm here, I'm very lucky to be here. I don't think I've done anything out of the world or extraordinary. I've been lucky to be at the right place at the right time. And that's what is, I think, a creative sort of disposition in my mind. So that is one aspect of what I do. I worked on acting workshops. I'm giving you this because after this, I would want it to be an interactive session. So I want us to have questions and answers if that's okay with that. And I think a couple of people are wearing yellow right now, so if you guys can spread yourselves out, it would be great. You already have. Okay, one person here, one person there, one person there. Anyway, it's a nice break. Now, coming back to improvisation. Someone told me, before we started the improv, that Indians can't be funny on the spot. It really bothered me. And at the same time, when I was doing my engineering at Ramaya, I am a mechanical engineer, I have a degree, I've graduated, just saying. When I was doing that, we used to do a lot of improvisation in the canteen and just waiter customer scenes where the waiter will not give the customer anything that he wants and just come and give all the things on the menu and just not like sort of give anything. And we used to do a lot of that. So I had one or two friends who used to do improvisation. And because of that, in 2010, I met a bunch of like-minded people, Kenneth Sebastian, Siddhan Sundar. They all were also on the same plane as I was. And Kenny was all of 21 when we started it. And Kenny, myself, Sid, we were jamming. And that's when we said, you know what, we're sitting at Allianz and we're like, let's do improvisation. Let's just book a date at Allianz and let's just do it. What do we call it? So I said, the something. And Kenny said, improv. So yeah, the improv. That's it. Sid was there. He said, the improv, and we were done. So we just got about 6-7 people. Went on stage. Nobody knew what it was 4 years ago. I mean, there were people who knew. I'm sure most of you have watched Whose Line Is It Anyway? Yeah. A lot of people, I was a big follower of that. And the moment that happened, we just went for the show and it was packed. And we were so surprised because we were just literally having fun on stage. We were not doing any of the, we were just having fun. It was like mother catches son masturbating. Is a situation we got from the audience. That was the first situation we got. Imagine. We were starting off, we said, guys, give us any situation that is awkward. That was, as a host, I went to the audience and said, give me an awkward situation. And lady who was in her 30s, late 30s, said, I want to see a mother catching her son masturbating. And I was like, wow, how's it going for you? Anyway, and then started, the journey started there. And it's been the most exciting 4 years for all of us because we just recently went to Sweden. And we were the only Indian team that got selected there. It was amazing because when we were talking to the other improvisers from UK, Argentina, Spain, US, the interaction was so amazing because they were asking us, how do you guys do that scene? And we were just like, okay, we followed these rules. There are rules to improvisation, obviously, but they're not set rules because improv is about agreement. If I say, if I ask you, hey buddy, would you like to have a cup of coffee with me? And as a friend, what would you say? So when you say yeah, that's it. The scene starts. If he says no, then I have to ask someone else. You know, you see what I'm saying? That's where. So the only rule of improvisation is be in agreement with your co-actor. And that is what we've been doing for the last 4 years. Because in improv now, there's a lot of people are wanting to join the improv because, oh, we want to get famous now because we already have a fan following. Let's go. Let's just be funny. Let's just crack amazing stand-up jokes and we'll be out of it. But improvisation is about acting. Because improvisation is a technique that actors use to be spontaneous with each other. And this is something that I learned when I was in the US. And it was amazing that in the last 4 years, every actor that's come and become a part of the improv, we've all learned something from each other because it's to do on-the-spot comedy. And to be also expressive is really, really something. And it's, when I as a host watch the actors when they're rehearsing, I'm literally intellectually getting orgasms all the time. Because it's something amazing. It's crazy to see that kind of energy and that kind of interactivity and speed in terms of being funny and humorous. So the improv is that one aspect. I've also been directing a bunch of ad films recently. So I've become a client pitch for a bit, which I think, yes, no, any filmmakers, yeah, I'm sure there are a couple of filmmakers. So have you guys worked with clients and agencies? So you know how it is, right? This is a script which is very bad, and they give it to you as a filmmaker, and the agency has written it, and the agency has somehow convinced the client that it's the best script in the world. I don't know how that happens. And they've convinced the client, and the client comes to you and says, okay, now please direct this, and make sure that the vision of the agency doesn't get diluted in the process. So what I've learned in the last 2 years with ad films is, do it for the money. But at the same time, all the creativity that you put into it, at some point there will be a time where you will get that one agency copy, which is like an ad for IDBI banks. You see those IDBI banks with the two cute kids? You see that ad? It's so well written, right? It's just one shot, two friends, and she's saying that, you know, that's it. And then you're like, wow, what an ad. So that is, so in the realm of the questions that I'm expecting to hear from you, and I think a lot more insider information will come out, as Karishma rightly said, workshops, which is what I started off. And I love teaching, I love talking to people about what I know, which is amazing because I feel that. I think it's a surge, it's a need, I feel. That's one. Second is films. I watch a lot of international cinema. I watch a film every day, one film every day, however busy I am, because that's how much I love knowing what's out there. Because every time I see a great film, I hate myself and I can't speak. Like I watched this movie called Room. Have you seen Room? Thank you for watching it. Room, it's an amazing film. And I was like, wow, why are people going and watching Batman vs. Superman when they can watch Room? Batman vs. Superman is today's kuch kuch hota hai. Right? Again, not judging, just saying. So films, because but before I went to the US, by the way, I was 22 and I went there, and all I watched at that point of time were Hindi cinema, Tamil films, Malayalam films. I had not watched Godfather. I'm not kidding you, I had not watched Godfather, I had not watched Star Wars. It was alien to me. So when I went and sat with 21 other people from different countries, I was the only Indian guy with longer hair and a very bad Manoj Nair Shaman lookalike. I was sitting there and they started talking, and the first film that my screenwriting teacher showed us was Before Sunrise. Have you seen Before Sunrise? Thank you. Those who haven't, please watch it, Before Sunrise. It's an amazing film. Even if you're not a filmmaker, please watch it. And I was like, what? I used to love Hero Number One. What happened to me? Coolie Number One also is one of my favorite films, to say. And I watched that and I was like, what a different dynamic shift, right? So films, improv. Because I think I love interacting with people. I used to be really mean earlier, 2 years ago. And I used to be a really mean host, and I used to fuck with the audience a lot. I can use that word, right? Yeah, thanks. You can just keep that out. We say flush every time I always say that. And I started, after a couple of shows, in the second year, an audience member came up to me, and she had gray hair, and she was like, I looked at her and was like, mom, that was the image in my head. And she came up to me and she said, it was a very good show. I really liked it. The energy was great. Can I tell you something? Can I talk to you for 2 minutes? I said, yeah, of course. So she took me to the side and she said, there's one thing is to be rude. And the other thing is to be rude and not be liked. You can be rude, but don't be rude and not be liked. It really stuck with me, and I think it was amazing for a person to come and share a nugget with me of something that would help me, which I find it fascinating, you know. I took my team in front of me, and every time I would be the host and watch my actors rehearse, I told my actors to watch me host a show and tell me where I'm being unnecessarily obtuse, or I'm trying to say something that I'm trying to take a person's statement and just for the heck of it do something to that person or say something which is just not go anywhere. I'd rather take someone's comedy and actually maybe appreciate that person's being funny. And that has kind of really changed over the last 1.5 years in improv, because when I'm hosting a show now, it's really about interacting with people and I know a lot of people, whenever a person with a mic comes forward, you obviously tend to go back like that. And that's okay, understand me, that this so happened to me. And when I was growing up, I was bullied in school. I was really bullied badly in school. And it really, really affected me. And there was one point where I kind of shut myself off of the bullying and I went away. And I used to also have this problem where I had a little bit of a stammering problem whenever I would speak in debates. And I started doing more debates and really falling flat in my first PUC. That really helped me, because someone told me at that point of time, if this is happening to you, just go all out. And I went all out. I started doing theater, even though I had a problem, I started doing theater. And it was great, because there were people who would come to me in the green room and advise me and tell me, not everyone is anti something. There are a lot of people who are pro things as well. And that pro things really, really helped me. So, improv. And finally, something that I'm also doing is, I really want to work on the landscape of Bangalore as much as I can in my own way, in terms of not letting people who are talented leave Bangalore to go to Bombay or Delhi or wherever. Because Bangalore is, it's got, we've got too many people that need creative catering. Doesn't mean that, you know, we need creative catering, and there's so much happening in Bangalore. Like I just recently moved to Bombay for 6 months to set up a film school. But I knew it was my contract, it was a consultancy thing. I did it and I finished and I came back because I love the city so much. Obviously the weather is kind of getting to me right now, but we'll figure that out. That's why we have that beautiful background there with greenery on the wall. Okay, alright guys, so that's it. I think this is pretty much who I am, and I would love to like make this an interactive session, so anyone wants to start off with a question, that'd be great. Production design, set design in a film. It's one of the most integral aspects of being a director, is to sit with your heads of departments before a particular shoot in pre-production, when you're planning the film. So for example, the main people that I have to work with, or any filmmaker, is once the writing part is over, once your screenwriting team, your writing team is done, then you move immediately to your cinematographer, because that person is giving visuals to your work, your art director or your production designer, yeah? And the second, your makeup, third, makeup and hair, fourth is stylist. So these are your four, and your final term in my mind is obviously your writing, your screenwriting. So production design, if you are approaching production design, I think you have to look at Wes Anderson's work, okay? You have to look at Paul Thomas Anderson's work, look at the French cinema, because French cinema, they are very, as much as they're existential, they're also very, very much about how to take a certain current reality and show it in a futuristic way without making it seem that futuristic. You know, it's like a beautiful balance. There's a movie called Her with Joaquin Phoenix. It's one of the most amazing set designs. So I think one will be to obviously use your architectural expertise and watch a lot of films and figure out what kind of production design you like. What you need to do with the director is first understand the leading idea that is starting and ending the movie, and your pivotal character, what that character is doing in that movie, and the main protagonists around the character that's helping the story forward. Once you know that, then in your mind you have an idea of a landscape. That idea then gets translated into pictures, into images. Yeah? Take a couple of movies, do annotations of those movies. For example, take a particular movie that you really like, is one way I would go, and go and shoot some frames of things that you like on your camera and go to the directors and meet them saying that if I was doing this movie, I would have art directed it this way. The person who's watching this as a director is not looking at whether that is right or not. He's looking at the initiative. That's all directors want, I think. They want to see someone. My film Station was edited by Kenneth Sebastian, who was 21 years old when he edited the film. And he's a brilliant editor because he gave me a non-linear edit to my film, which was linear, and I had gone to two editors beforehand. It has nothing to do with age. It has everything to do with you coming and saying, I want to do this. Why would people not go to Bombay? Why would people not stay here? Okay, so this would have been, it would have been true 5 years back. Look at everyone who's been successful from Bangalore today, in terms of going to Bombay and making it. Kannan, Kenny, Sumukhi. But I feel that the fact of, you know, going away, it's not that more talent is not going to come, but the city has a lot. There are so many people who go watch. Our improvisation show that we did on a Tuesday night at Chowdeya, which is 1,000-seater, was packed and 600 people went without tickets. So it is there. There is an audience for everything. And the point is that a lot of creative people here, there is a, I would say this one word, which is being selfish, is something that's really making it very weird. I think sharing ideas, a lot of filmmakers don't meet and share ideas because they feel, oh, you take my idea, like I'm screwed. But what if the other person takes your idea, you take someone else's idea, it's okay. I mean, it's a karmic thing. Why does it have to be that I can't share my idea? If I have an amazing script and an amazing idea, if I call three other filmmakers and I talk to them about the idea, and if it's an unselfish exchange, then 150% what they say will add value to my product. Does it make sense? So we can still be here and do something. The only way is that the avenues are there today. So Adeep asked me when you, a client comes with a preconceived notion, and if you're an agency representative or an agency's creative, how do you make sure that you are taking what they want and delivering on that? Okay, so my response to that is, whenever I meet a client or an agency, or say for example I meet an agency person, I really don't get into the creatives these days. Because I feel that my job, they've called me for a specific job. They want me to visually direct this and give me an end product. If the agency team is friendly with me and they want my suggestions on the creative, of course I'll give them. But if they come to me with a bound script and say, Saad, this is an execution project, I take it up as an execution. That's what I do. But having said that, I want to add something. 1 year ago, all the digital films that come online, they had some story to tell. Right? The hashtags, everything that they were doing were very ingenious, were very interesting, people are sharing. I'm talking about 1 year ago. Now when you see a digital brand film, very few people sharing everything, because it's not about the story anymore. It's about, let's put the right keywords so people will watch. So for me now, when I talk to an agency, I ask them a question. I said, you've written this script, what is the end purpose of this? What are you trying to achieve out of it? Give it a, it's a functional film, Saad. Don't put your mind together. It's a functional film. I want to show service. That's it. I'll show service then. But I say, no, it's a functional film, Saad, but it's really, it's very drab. I want to do something about it. So then I'm like, okay, let's sit, let's brainstorm. But I personally feel that in every agency, like for example, you're creative, right? You will have that one eureka moment that will be fantastic and you shouldn't rush it. And if it's already happened, then I congratulate you. Krishna. So Krishna, I'm going to first answer the question about the movies that I'm comparing. So I'm not saying I don't like Batman vs Superman. I'm not saying that I don't like Bali. I'm saying that every film has an audience. And the moment as an audience, we stop typecasting what kind of film it is, we open out the environment. Every time someone asks me, what kind of a film are you making? Is it an independent film? Is it a feature film? I tell them it's a film. I don't put it in a subcategory of something. That is one part of it. The other part of it, whether you think that it will become more mainstream, the independent films that we're doing, like more films like Gangs of Wasseypur, more films like Titi, the kind of film that's releasing, will they get more mainstream? I feel that we are already conditioned to a certain kind of films, which is very okay, by the way, because if we remove song and dance from our Bollywood films and from our films, I think we're going to lose a lot of soul. We will, because that's what it is. Having said that, the audiences that are watching independent films are watching it because they want to be creatively enthused. So Whiplash was a very good example because the writer and the director both got credit for it. And what the director does to a script is, a director first reads the script many times, which is what I do, and then you want format I follow. I give the script to another friend who's a director and have a discussion of what they think about the script. Where are they going with it? I sit with the writer and understand that if in a particular place I didn't understand something, what was the motivation? And I always try to, and someone told me this, a filmmaker told me this, beautiful line, he said to me, Saad, don't make, say. Don't try to create, say. Saying has a lot of value to a project. So when I sit with the writer, I said, what are you trying to say in this movie? Right? So the film that I'm doing, a Hollywood film, is called Love and She. So when I started with the writers, I asked them, it was an American writer and African-American writer, they both wrote the script. I said, what is this movie saying? What is this script saying? And they told me it is talking about a couple's isolation because of miscarriage, because of stillbirth, and because of the technology that's in their lives that is not allowing them to talk about their problem. For me, it was like, wow, I wanted to direct it immediately. And I'm so happy I did. Irrespective of whether it really releases, it's in 2-3 film festivals now, irrespective of whether it releases or not, for me, it was a learning process. I learned so much from that project. So when I read a script, I'll first tell you about me, and I didn't give you one or two examples. When I read a script, for me, it's about the character and the motivation and where it's going. I understand that, and then I improvise a little bit, because otherwise it becomes about that the actors come on set very prepared with the line. Then they're not interacting with each other. For me, moment to moment spontaneity between two people is acting. It's very important that there is an action reaction going on. There's a very famous French director called Jacques Audiard. What Jacques Audiard does is he takes a script and he makes the actors backward and forward completely by heart the script. Then after that, he doesn't meet them for 1 month. And in the 1 month, he said, don't touch the script. Come back now. Now show me your characters that you prepared based on your understanding of the script. So I love following a great idea. So even if I don't have something, I'll follow this great idea. Because this works for me, because I love improvisation. I know that I want to let my actors come and understand the environment and the space and then act. I don't want them to come and be actors because they're motivated themselves to be a person with ego or to be a person with narcissism. I want them to feel that within the environment. It can just be simply, I'm holding this or I'm feeling this and I feel like I have attitude just by using this prop. If an actor does that for me, believably, and the co-actor gives that response, I think the scene is going. Communication is very important. When you're communicating something to an actor, and you're communicating something to an art director, you're communicating something to your cinematographer or your DP, or you're communicating something to the spot boy. All these people have to be treated the same, according to me, as a director. There should not be any hierarchy. Just because he is a light man, I'm like, Raju! Or just because he is a DOP, like, sir, no. I think each person has to be treated the same, which is complete equality from every part of that spectrum. Complete equality is what I would say. Secondly, very importantly, is the moment you respect people from in least power on your set, that is where everyone will start talking to you that you're the captain of the ship. The moment you put down people who are the gaffer, the light men, the people who are your assistant sound, who's taking Foley with the boom, and you start treating them with a sense of that they are not important, that they're just a very, very small aspect of the car, and it might just not be even on the number plate, then you are, as a director, you are, and this I used to, 3 years ago, I used to be very aggressive on the set, and I used to really, really put all the aggression onto like a lightman and all that, and then a lot of things started changing when I started really looking at their work with a lot of interest in detail. So the director's role is the captain of the ship, and the captain of the ship can only be treated like a captain of the ship when he creates equality on the set. I am a filmmaker because I want my audience to see my films, according to me. I don't want my parents and my 4 friends to watch my films. Because they anyway will watch. They anyway, if I make something, or I just shoot this and I take it to my mom, she'll 100% watch it 8 times and she'll say, beta, you're so talented. But I want to reach out to an audience to tell a story, to project a story, to say a story. So definitely for me, the intent is, I don't want the audience to love it, I want the conversation to begin. Like the Love and She movie, you might come back and say that Saad was the most depressing film, I hate you, I don't want to talk to you again. But at least you're thinking about it, you're making a conversation. Someone might come and say that your research was very, very limited on the film. Screw you, I had a very miscarriage, I don't behave like that. But there's an interaction that started, that's all. Okay guys, thank you so much for indulging me. Thank you. Thank you so much.